So, Joshua chapter 15, as I've been mentioning, you know, it's another one of these passages. There's 63 verses. It's a pretty long passage. And we're not going to go through and revisit every single verse again. There's just a lot of places that are listed off. And basically, this entire chapter is just telling us all of the territory that was given unto Judah. This is a lot of land. Judah has a big portion in Israel. And you can just see that just even without knowing all the geography. I mean, you just see all the places that it's listing off and then all the cities and the villages thereof. You know, we go through and it lists off all of those things. And of course, we saw Caleb is of the tribe of Judah. And we talked about Caleb last week. But there's a few points that I want to hit that come up in this passage that I'm going to dive in a little bit deeper than just what we see on the surface and kind of teach on these subjects, on these things that we find in this chapter. And the first one that we come across I want to teach on is found in verse number 8. So there's a place that's mentioned here, but it has a lot of significance in Scripture. So we're going to go into this. Verse number 8, the Bible says, "And the border went up by the valley of the son of Hinnom unto the south side of the Jebusite, the same is Jerusalem." So the valley of the son of Hinnom, which is right outside of Jerusalem, is a very significant place in Scripture. It's a place that was used and referenced in Scripture as a place that where false gods were set up and where people would sacrifice their children through the fire to their false gods and shed the blood of innocent children as something that was not just, you know, like a euphemism. It's not just symbolic. It was really wicked. They worshipped Baal and false gods, just devils. And one of the ways that they did that was by sacrificing their children. And this was all taking place in the valley of the son of Hinnom. Another word that you'll see alongside the valley of the son of Hinnom is Tophet. So you'll see Tophet, that is in the valley of the son of Hinnom. And again, it's referencing the altars that were built up to false gods. Now, turn if you would, keep your finger here in Joshua. Turn if you would to 2 Kings chapter number 23. 2 Kings chapter 23, we're going to see what King Josiah does to Tophet, or the valley of the sons of Hinnom, or the children of Hinnom. You'll notice there's a few different ways the Bible references is the children of Hinnom, or the son of Hinnom, or the sons of Hinnom, or you'll see Tophet or both. Now, 2 Kings chapter 23 is talking about King Josiah. King Josiah is one of my favorite all-time Bible characters. This guy's awesome. This guy comes in. He was prophesied. If you remember all the way back when Jeroboam the son of Nebat. Why his name was escaping me. Jeroboam the son of Nebat, right? He was the first king of Israel when God divided the kingdom from Solomon's son Rehoboam. Rehoboam was the king of Judah, and then he split the kingdom, and Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, became the king of Israel for the sins of Solomon. And when he did that, right away, it seems, Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, did a really wicked thing, and he set up these altars. And he set up these altars and got the people not to go down to Jerusalem to worship, but to worship at these altars. And he created these idols and he caused Israel to go into sin. And from that point forward, Israel has like pretty much always been just, you know, the spiritually dark. They've had a few light moments in their, you know, in their history, but overall they're spiritually dark and it kind of all stemmed back to that. And Jeroboam the son of Nebat is referenced throughout Scripture as like a standard for doing wickedly. You know, he did really wicked, but not as bad as Jeroboam the son of Nebat. And you'll see that about different kings, you know, being referenced as he's kind of the standard of being wicked. So why am I bringing that up? Well, when he erected the altar, there was the man of God that came out and prophesied against the altar, and the altar was rent. But then he said that he made this prophecy that, you know, the bones of the prophets of Baal and the land, the people of the land that were doing this, they were going to be burned on an altar. It was going to be defiled and desecrated, and that Josiah by name was going to come and do all this. And this is like some 400 years prior to King Josiah actually coming into power at 8 years old, you know, and ruling and reigning, and then fulfilling all of this prophecy, which is really cool. But what I love about King Josiah is how he really just pushed the reset button and said, no, we're going to follow the Lord, and we're going to follow him holy, and we're going to get all this mess. He inherited this great mess. And he didn't even know, like his heart was seeking and searching as a child, and he's trying to do what was right, and he's trying to repair the house of the Lord. And in his efforts to try to do right and get back to the old religion, they find a copy of the scriptures, of the law. They're like, hey, look what we found. They like dust off the book, and then they read it to him, and it pierced his heart because he realized, man, you know, we are way off base. He hears scripture, he hears God's word, and he's like, our fathers have been doing things wrong. You know, we got to get things right. And he really starts putting forward a lot of things into place. And we'll read a little bit of this starting in, let's see. Start reading in, verse number 4 of 2 Kings 23. Bible says, and the king commanded Hilkiah the high priest and the priests of the second order and the keepers of the door to bring forth out of the temple of the Lord all the vessels that were made for Baal and for the grove and for all the host of heaven. And he burned them without Jerusalem in the fields of Kidron and carried the ashes of them unto Bethel. So he's getting all the idolatry out. You know, they defiled the temple of the Lord. They brought in all these just abominable things that to worship the whole host of heaven, all these various gods. So he's cleaning that up. Verse number 5, it says, and he put down the idolatrous priests whom the kings of Judah had ordained to burn incense in the high places in the cities of Judah and in the places round about Jerusalem. This is no joke. I mean, he's like putting people to death. He's saying, no, we're not doing this anymore. These guys are wicked and they're being put to death. It says, them also that burned incense unto Baal, to the sun, and to the moon, and to the planets, and to all the host of heaven. Verse number 6, and he brought out the grove from the house of the Lord without Jerusalem under the brook Kidron, and burned it at the brook Kidron, and stamped it small to powder, and cast the powder thereof upon the graves of the children of the people. Again, the reference to the groves is just more idolatrous practices, more just false religion and worship of devils. And they brought all this stuff into God's house. They just incorporated it into the temple of the Lord and just said, oh, we're just going to learn after the way the heathen worships their gods, and we're just going to bring that into church. Verse number 7, and he brake down the houses of the Sodomites. And this is one of the main reasons why I love this guy, because there's a few kings throughout the history where they just said, you know what, we're getting rid of this, of these vile fags, and they're not going to be allowed in our land anymore. Like get out. All right? And they chase them out, and they drive them out. It says, and he brake down the houses of the Sodomites. And look at it, it says, that were by the house of the Lord. I mean, even the Sodomites are just living right up next to church, right up next to the temple, right up next to the house of God. You've got dogs living right next door. And he says, nope, that's not happening, not on my watch. He broke them down and drove them out. It says, where the women wove hangings for the grove. Verse number 8, and he brought all the priests out of the cities of Judah and defiled the high places where the priests had burnt incense from Geba to Beersheba and break down the high places of the gates that were in the entering of the gate of Joshua, the governor of the city, which were on a man's left hand at the gate of the city. Verse number 9, nevertheless, the priests of the high places came not up to the altar of the Lord in Jerusalem, but they did eat of the unleavened bread among their brethren. And he defiled Topheth, which is in the valley of the children of Hinnom, that no man might make his son or his daughter to pass through the fire to Molech. Molech was the name of one of the false gods, that they would literally cause their children to pass through the fire unto this false god. It's just a sacrifice that they were making. This is obviously an extremely wicked thing. But it also goes to show you how much Satan likes to still try to steal things from God and from the truth and then pervert them and twist them and turn it into something that's wicked. The Lord sacrificed His only begotten Son for us. He doesn't demand or expect us to sacrifice our only children and make them pass through the fire, you know, to please Him or to satisfy Him. That can't satisfy Him. That's not going to satisfy His judgment. Why? Because it's already been satisfied through His own Son. And this is turning the whole gospel backwards. And, I mean, that's just one reason why it's so wicked. But you see how Satan likes to take something that is true about Jesus Christ being sacrificed for us and turn it around on its head to turn it into this weird works and just really disturbing practice of sacrificing your own children unto this false god. So it says He defiled it. He basically just broke it up, destroyed it, and made it so that they couldn't use that anymore. That's one reference here to the children of Hinnom, or the valley of the children of Hinnom. Now, I had read somewhere, and be careful with what you read online because a lot of it is just completely untrue and not factual at all. When I was preparing for this sermon, I read somewhere that it was a Jewish ritual of child sacrifice, and referring to the valley of the children of Hinnom, and just implying that like they're the ones that came up with it. But the reason why I'm even bringing this up, and that's because that's completely false. We see in the book of Joshua the reference to the valley of the children of Hinnom. The children of Hinnom in that valley, obviously there's a man named Hinnom, which we don't really know anything about, but his family, his children, his descendants were the ones that started this, and that you know, their valley is where this took place and all this wickedness. Now, we have concrete evidence in Scripture that says that the people of the land, the Canaanites, were doing this practice. They were the ones offering their children. Well, I mean, where do you think the children of Israel learned it from? They didn't just come up with it on their own. The god Molech had been around prior to them coming into the land. But because they did not destroy all the inhabitants of the land like God told them to do, there was a remnant left that was able to defile them and bring in their false religion and be a plague unto them and turn their heart away from serving the Lord by even just having them all learn about it. They're all able to oh, so what do you guys do? Oh, who do you worship? Oh, what do you do? Well, we'll take that, we'll incorporate that into our religion. We'll just bring people, oh, I like that. Let's include that. All this wickedness. Now, in 2 Chronicles, though, and I'll just read this for you. Turn, if you would, to Jeremiah chapter 19. Jeremiah 19. In 2 Chronicles 28, verse 3, the Bible says, "Moreover, he burnt incense in the valley of the son of Hinnom and burnt his children in the fire after the abomination of the heathen whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel." So it's very clear, the scripture is saying, look, this is exactly the way that the heathen used to do it before they were cast out, and then Israel began doing it too. Now, it's really wicked that Israel began to do it, but they weren't the ones that originally came up with it. So all that said, just to say, be careful what you read online. Now, another reason why I'm bringing this up and why I think this is an important teaching to talk about the valley of the son of Hinnom is because what that really means, the valley of the son of Hinnom is really just Gehenna. Who's here has ever heard the word Gehenna before? Gehenna is a word that's translated in the King James Bible as hell. Gehenna, Hades, Sheol are all words that are Greek and Hebrew words that are translated as hell in the King James Bible. Now, the deceivers out there will try to tell you and teach you that, oh, no, the King James Bible is wrong when it uses the word hell because it's really just talking about the valley of the son of Hinnom. It's talking about this place. It's talking about this garbage dump that's burning outside of Jerusalem, that's all that is. It's not some, you know, eternal torture and torment place that, you know, Western civilization has made out this big thing called hell. And because the King James Bible uses that word, it's very deceptive. And there are a lot of people out there that will try to teach you this garbage and this nonsense. That's what is garbage. But we're going to, it's important still to understand the truth about all this stuff, because we need to know the truth about everything, right? I mean, we're not afraid of looking at stuff. It's not going to challenge what you believe, but maybe it'll help you to provide answers for people who you might not have ever heard this before, and someone brings it up. Well, now you're going to know why everything is the way that it is and what everything really means. So you won't be caught off guard by someone who might want to challenge you on this, especially because the people who want to challenge you the most on this could be like Jehovah's Witnesses. And we'll get into that in just a minute. But basically, the Valley of the Son of Hinnom, think of Gehenna, Hinnom, very similar. That's where it comes from. Now, I might not even be pronouncing Gehenna properly. I'm pronouncing it in the English vernacular, right? But that's coming from the Hebrew. But it's translated as hell. Now, we see here in our passage, we see the Valley of the Son of Hinnom is not translated as hell every single time, because it's not the word Gehenna that's used there. It's referring to the place, the Valley of the Son of Hinnom. But when you realize, and we're going to see this description in Jeremiah 19, why Gehenna is used as a picture, as an illustration of hell. When you really understand everything that was going on there, that this is a pretty appropriate name to use as a reference to the eternal judgment place. It's something. It's like the closest thing that you could probably find here on earth as making an example of this is what the afterlife is like. And it's similar to the Bible using the Greek word Hades. Because, you know, that's another word that people have a general understanding of what the place is. It's not saying that, you know, the Greeks were right in their mythology about the underworld. It's using that as a term, but it describes these places when it's using a term and relating it to the afterlife. There is no doubt, and there should be no doubt, what that place is like when we read all of the context in Scripture. So let's look at Jeremiah 19, though, before I get too far ahead of myself. Jeremiah chapter 19, we're going to start reading in verse number 3. The Bible says, "And say, hear ye the word of the Lord, O kings of Judah, and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will bring evil upon this place, the which whosoever heareth, his ears shall tingle." Okay, just right off the bat, he's saying, I'm going to bring so much evil and destruction and pain against this place that even the people that hear about it, their ears are going to ting. It's going to be like, whoa. You know, like, that really happened there? It is not going to go unnoticed at all. It's a very, very significant damage that's going to come. Let's keep reading about it. It says, verse number 4, "Because they have forsaken me, and have estranged this place, and have burned incense in it unto other gods, whom neither they nor their fathers have known, nor the kings of Judah, and have filled this place with the blood of innocents." That's referring to the child sacrifices, the blood of innocents, innocent children just being destroyed in that place. Verse number 5, "They have built also the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings unto Baal." Again, this language isn't being used. They burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings. That's not just saying, oh, well, it's just figuratively talking about them making these big, you know, these mock sacrifices. That's what some apologists and these commentators of the Bible are going to say, well, they didn't really do that, but they just performed these rituals where they just made a mock sacrifice. Well, that's not what the Scripture says. It doesn't say they pretended to sacrifice their children with fire. It didn't say they intended to, or they just wanted to show this. No, it says they built the high places to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings. That's what they built them for, to do it, and they did it. It says, "Which I commanded not, nor spake it, neither came it into my mind." That's another good verse to show to a Calvinist who wants to say that, oh, God's responsible for everything and he's sovereign and he's in control of everything and the evil that people do, well, that's because God made them do it. These hyper-Calvinists. Well, the people that were sacrificing their children and making them burn in fire, God said that didn't even come into my mind. So if he's the one making them do it, how could he say it didn't even come into my mind and be telling the truth? Wicked Calvinist doctrine. Watch out for that, but I'm not getting into that tonight. Let's keep reading. Verse number 6. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that this place shall no more be called Tophet, nor the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter. And I will make void the council of Judah and Jerusalem in this place, and I will cause them to fall by the sword before their enemies and by the hands of them that seek their lives. And their carcasses will I give to be meat for the fowls of the heaven and for the beasts of the earth. And I will make this city desolate and in hissing. Everyone that passeth thereby shall be astonished and hiss because of all the plagues thereof. And I will cause them, look at this, and I will cause them to eat the flesh of their sons and the flesh of their daughters. And they shall eat everyone the flesh of his friend in the siege and straitness wherewith their enemies and they that seek their lives shall straiten them. Talk about a pretty hellish place where you're eating your own children and your friends, and it's a valley of innocent blood being shed, and God says, I'm going to turn it into a valley of slaughter because they're all just going to be wiped out. It says in verse number 10, then shalt thou break the bottle in the sight of the men that go with thee, and shalt say unto them, thus saith the Lord of hosts, even so will I break this people in this city as one breaketh a potter's vessel that cannot be made whole again. And they shall bury them in Tophet till there be no place to bury. It's going to be such a slaughter, he says. They're going to be burying and burying and burying, he said, till there's just no more graves left to bury all the dead bodies. That is a place of death. That is a place of utter destruction. That is a place of just torture and pain and a horrible... I mean, can you think of a much worse place to be on earth? It makes sense that he says, look, your ears are going to tingle when you hear about this place. And it makes sense to use a place like that to be the word that you use to describe the afterlife place of torture and torment and burning and everything else. People knew this place. You could relate to that. But it's very clear in Scripture that it is definitely talking about the afterlife. And it's not talking about the physical location of the Valley of the Children of Hinnom. But it's using the word Gehenna, or it'll use the word Hades or Sheol. It'll use these words that, yes, maybe references to certain places, but as much of a descriptive value as it has to refer to the actual hell or the lake of fire that is found in Scripture. I'm going to read for you some of the Jehovah's false witness hypocrisy and the double speak that they use. And this is common in all of their literature and everything that they do and everything that they promote. They speak out of both sides of their mouth. They want to have things both ways. And I'm going to give you a perfect example of this. This is straight from their website, jw.org. This isn't from someone who's angry with the Jehovah's Witnesses. This is what they teach. This is on their website. I'm going to read this for you because this is their explanation of Gehenna. And they say, it is no symbol of everlasting torment. Nope, can't be. Why? Because the Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe that hell is a place of everlasting, eternal torture or torment. They believe in annihilation. They believe that people who are not saved, they just get, you know, yeah, they go to hell, but then they're just burned up and they just cease to exist. And they're separated from God eternally. And that is torture in and of itself, just not being with God. Or they just don't even, they just say they don't even have consciousness, right? They're separated from God and they don't have any consciousness, and that's hell. They cease to exist. So I'm going to read you their explanation of this, and especially when it comes to Gehenna, because We'll get into it. I'm going to read this for you. Here's what they say. Jesus Christ associated fire with Gehenna. And then it gives a few text verses in Matthew and Mark, which it's not even all of them. They just list a couple there. And it's very interesting the way they do that too. It says, as did the disciple James, the only biblical writer besides Matthew, Mark, and Luke to use the word. James 3:6 is the reference there. It says, some commentators endeavor to link such fiery characteristic of Gehenna with the burning of human sacrifices that was carried on prior to Josiah's reign, and on this basis hold that Gehenna was used by Jesus as a symbol of everlasting torment. So they're saying some commentators will say that, you know, this is why Gehenna was used as this symbol of everlasting torment that Jesus taught. And they're saying, well, some people will say that, but they're going to explain why that's not the case. They say, however, since Jehovah God expressed repugnance for such practice, saying that it was a thing that I had not commanded and that had not come into my heart, it seems most unlikely that God's Son, in discussing divine judgment, would make such idolatrous practice the basis for the symbolic meaning of Gehenna. It may be noted that God prophetically decreed that the Valley of Hinnom would serve as a place for mass disposal of dead bodies rather than for the torture of live victims. So I'm going to repeat what they're saying here, and just because they add a lot of fluff to it, but when you boil it down, what they're saying is it's unlikely that Jesus, that God's Son, in referring to the divine judgment, in referring to the afterlife, would use an idolatrous practice of people sacrificing their children as a symbolic meaning for Gehenna. They're saying it's unlikely that he would even do that because God hated that practice and disapproved of it, then he wouldn't use that. I mean, there's no way he would use that to talk about Gehenna and talk about divine judgment, right? They want divine judgment as like this godly, you know, like this good thing or whatever, which it is. I get that. But, they're trying to spin this as, well, God would never use something so wicked in his divine plan, right? Even as a symbol. But then in the next words on this website says, The symbolic of complete destruction. So their header was, the first one I just read, no symbol of everlasting torment, symbolic of complete destruction, because that's their doctrine, right? So they're saying it's not torture, it's just total destruction, and that's what the symbolism is. So they say this, it is evident that Jesus used Gehenna as representative of our utter destruction. Well, wait a minute. I thought Jesus was above using such an idolatrous practice in God's divine judgment. You see, when they use those words and they'll use that argument when they don't like it being about torture, but then they say, well, no, it actually is about divine judgment. Well, which one is it? Because you just said both within a few sentences. But the followers of this false religion won't see that because they're full of pride. Because they want to sound so smart. Oh, you don't know what Gehenna is. You don't know what this place is actually talking about. This isn't talking about everlasting torture. This is talking about a place of destruction. This is where they went and they just burned bodies and their refuse and their garbage. They just burned it up and it went away. It didn't last forever and ever, ever. So that can't be referring to Gehenna. Well, yeah, because it's physical. When you physically burn stuff, it is going to burn up here. That's why, you know, hell is talking about your soul being burned. Because that doesn't just go away. But then they buy into the Jewish fables that hell is not real, because that's ultimately where it comes from. It comes from Jewish fables. The Jehovah's Witnesses didn't come up with that on their own either. They stole it from the Jews. That hell's not real, or at least it's not eternal. Some more of their writings. And this is just so that you're aware of what they believe, because they may come and try to bring this at you. And just to have an answer on this, the Bible says, therefore, or not, whoa, hold on a second. The Bible doesn't say this. The Bible does not say this. JW.org says this, okay? Therefore, the biblical evidence concerning Gehenna generally parallels the traditional view presented by rabbinic and other sources. Rabbinic, rabbis, the Jews. That view is that the Valley of Hinnom was used as a place for the disposal of waste matter from the city of Jerusalem. And then it says, Matthew 5:30 renders Gehenna as a rubbish heap. Concerning Gehinnom, the Jewish commentator David Kimhai, in his comment on Psalm 27:13, gives the following historical information. And it is a place in the land adjoining Jerusalem, and it is a loathsome place, and they throw there unclean things and carcasses. Also, there was a continual fire there to burn the unclean things and the bones of the carcasses. Hence, the judgment of the wicked ones is called parabolically Gehenna. So, even after they just said, you know, this isn't in reference to divine judgment, everything else they say after that is, yeah, this is talking about the judgment. But it's not referring to it being everlasting, right? Well, even the Jew that he quote is saying that there's a continual fire burning there. And it was a place where just this they just keep throwing more refuse in there. And these bodies and whatever, and it's just continually burning. Well, I think that's about as close of a reference that you can get to hell on this earth. It makes sense that you're going to use that word Gehenna when that's what's happening. But see, what they want to say is, no, it's really just that place. That's it. So every reference, every time you see Gehenna, it's just talking about that place. It's not actually talking about a literal hell that people are going to be thrown into when they die, or that people go to when they die. It's ridiculous. Turn, if you would, to Mark chapter number 9. Because this is actually one of the verses that they reference. So we previously read from their site, Jesus Christ associated fire with Gehenna. And then they quote, they say in parentheses, you know, Matthew 5:22, 18:9, and then Mark 9:47 and 48. But yeah, but see, it's more than just 47 and 48. There's actually, you know, quite a few verses in this passage in Mark chapter 9. And many of you are probably already familiar with this passage, but we're going to look it up anyways. This is actually a great passage to show people that hell's a real place. So one of the places I turn to if someone has a problem believing that hell is real, the first places I turn to is, of course, in Revelation. But then, you know, if people want to say, look, Jesus taught about hell. If I go to Luke 16, Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9, especially when people don't believe hell is forever, that it's eternal. It's a great place to show them that. It's the same place that even the JWs are admitting that he's associating fire with Gehenna. Well, let's read the passage, Mark 9, verse number 43. We're going to read more than just what they reference. We're going to start in verse number 43. And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands, to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter halt into life than having two feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into hellfire, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. Does anyone have a hard time seeing the difference between entering into life and entering into hell? Entering into good or entering into bad? And he's saying, look, if you've got a problem with this, cut it off, because it's way better for you. It's way better to be saved. It's way better in your life than it is to be going into this hellfire. And then it describes it a little bit. Jesus is describing it, saying, look, the fire is not quenched, which means it's not put out. Now, is that fire in, you say, literal, in the valley of the son of Hinnom, the children of Hinnom? Did that fire go out? I think it did. I don't think it's still burning to this day. I think that fire's gone, dead, put out. Jesus said the fire is never going out. You think he's just referring to that one place when he says the fire is never going to be put out? It says, into the fire that never shall be quenched. And it also says, where their worm dieth not. I think the worms that might have been, you know, eating the flesh of whatever is thrown into their trash heap, if it's being burnt, I don't know any worms that survive the fire physically on this earth. I've never seen a worm crawl in the midst of fire. It's a pretty good way to kill worms and kill maggots and kill whatever that would eat through carcasses of things. But Jesus says that this place, their worm doesn't die. They're being eaten of worms and eternally burning forever. I mean, that's what's being described here. So the JW website says, some commentators endeavor to link such fiery characteristics of Gehenna with the burning of human sacrifices that was carried on prior to Josiah's reign, and on this basis hold that Gehenna was used by Jesus as a symbol of everlasting torture or torment. Yeah, I wonder how anyone could ever imagine that. Some commentators. Yeah, because it's such a big stretch to see that Jesus was talking about everlasting torment in these passages that use the word Gehenna. Because that's what's used when you go back to the underlying language. That's what's being used here. I don't know. Maybe we get this idea of eternal torture not even just from the word Gehenna, but because the same concept is taught elsewhere in the Bible that doesn't use Gehenna, that doesn't use Hades, and that doesn't use Sheol. Like Revelation chapter 14. This is actually my favorite place to turn to. I always turn to this verse if I'm trying to explain hell to somebody or if I run into a JW or whatever. Revelation 14 is my go-to to show this and to demonstrate this. Because it doesn't use the word Gehenna. Because it is very clear. Because it is just, you cannot get past the language that's used here, that there is a real place of hell where people will go to and suffer and be tortured forever. It's not just destruction. They don't just cease to exist. Hell's a real place. That's why we need a Savior. Revelation 14, verse number 10. Actually, let's go up to like verse number 9. I only got 10 in my notes. Let me turn there real quick. Because this is just in reference to, and I'm always, look, I recommend this also. Anytime you're explaining the gospel or explaining anything about the Bible to people, be honest. Don't ever try to like use a verse that's really not quite in that context. Even if you're teaching them a biblical truth, don't go and start cherry-picking verses that really don't have to do with that or maybe that have a different meaning or whatever without just being upfront and honest, because if they go back and study it and they realize that's not what this, you know, like even if you're teaching them something that's true, don't do that. That's being dishonest and you're not going to win people over that way. In the context of Revelation 14, this is talking about people who take the mark of the beast. But it doesn't matter, because the concept of somebody being tortured and tormented forever, regardless of who it actually is found in Scripture. And we could argue, we already know and believe that it's true that people who go to hell are going to be burned and tortured forever. But in this specific context, it's talking about people who take the mark of the beast. And I'll limit it to that context when I'm talking to a JW and just be like, okay, well, look, is there a group of people, yes or no, whether it's people alive today or not, or people who've died before, it doesn't matter. Is there a group of people that will be tortured forever in fire, in brimstone? Because if you deny that, you're denying literally what the Bible actually says. You don't have to argue about who the people specifically are. It's, will they even admit that it exists? See, they don't think it exists because they say, oh, well, a loving God would never torture somebody forever. Just demonstrating they don't know the right God at all. They claim that, oh, we know him because we know his name. His name is Jehovah. Like, you don't even know God. You know, they don't have Jesus. They don't think Jesus is God. They don't have God. They don't have the Father because they don't have the Son. But look at what the Bible says here in Revelation chapter 14. Look at verse number 9. And it says, and the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man, not any devil, any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture in the cup of his indignation. And he, who's this? The man that receives the mark of the beast, shall be tormented. It doesn't say he shall be tormented by being separated from God. It doesn't say he shall be tormented by not existing. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone. There's where the torture and torment's coming from. It's coming from the fire and the brimstone. In the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. They are going to be in Jesus Christ's presence while being tortured and tormented in fire and brimstone. And verse number 11 says, and the smoke of their torment. The words again, torment, torture, ascendeth up forever and ever. Why does the smoke ascend up forever and ever? Because the fire is not quenched. Because it goes eternally. And is it? Are they just cast in there? And then, okay, well, maybe it hurts for a minute and then they're just burned up because it can't last forever. Well, if we keep reading the verse, it says, and they have no rest day nor night. So are they just consumed and burned up? No, because they don't have rest. If they cease to exist, that sounds like a rest to me. Like, what better rest can you have? You know, when you sleep like you're dead, that's some good rest. If I go to bed and like nothing wakes me up, that is some good rest. Man, I love that. When there's no kids crying and dogs barking and noises and lights and whatever. Who knows? You come into my house for a while, you never know what you're going to get when you try to get a good night's rest. But man, just being out cold, that is some good rest. But the people that go to hell, they have no rest. Day, night, doesn't matter. Why? Because they're being tortured and tormented because they're in flames. Fire and brimstone. It says, who worship the beast in his image and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. That's what it's talking about. You get someone to accept, you get a JW to accept that, then you can start talking about, well, other people go there too, not just the people who take the mark of the beast. But you deny that, you can't accept what the Bible says there, see ya. Give you one or two admonitions and that's it. Because, you know, you cannot dance around this. This says what it says. And people are unwilling to accept the Bible for what it says. Your heart's not ready to get saved because you're not, you can't just accept the Bible for what it says. You have your own religion, your own rules, your own law, whatever it is your heart wants to follow. You don't care about the truth when it smacks you in the face. All right. Next subject, Joshua chapter 15. So that was just to give you a little bit of information. The valley of the children of Hinnom, the valley of the sons of Hinnom equals Gehenna. I mean, that's where the word comes from. That's literally what the word means. It's a place outside of Jerusalem. It's a real place where people sacrifice their children in the fire to false gods, but it's also the word that's translated as hell. And it's interesting because the KJV is the only Bible that translates all of those words as hell. The modern versions will all transliterate some of those words. You'll see Hades, you'll see Sheol, you'll see Gehenna, whatever, right? Depending on which translation and how they do it, they don't all, none of them will translate those words as hell. And they're wrong. Because the places the King James Bible translates them hell, it's talking about the afterlife. It's talking about the place where wicked people go when they die. And we don't need to you know, change that. Or let me put it this way. The KJV is not wrong when it translates them as hell. A word transliterated, I'm not going to say is wrong. If it's the word that's literally found in the original language, but we don't need to have transliterated word when we have an English word that means the same thing. So the next concept that I see in Joshua 15 I want to go over tonight is found in verse number 16. So this is when, you know, Caleb has already gotten his land. And he says there in verse 16, Caleb said, "He that smiteth Kirjath Sefer and taketh it, to him will I give Aksa my daughter to wife. And Othniel the son of Kenaz, the brother of Caleb, took it, and he gave him Aksa his daughter to wife." Now, I'm going to cover just briefly here. Turn, if you would, to Exodus chapter 22. Just this concept of a man giving his daughter to wife. And it's a concept that, I mean, in feminist America, is going to be ridiculed and looked down upon and mocked, and you're going to be crazy if you even talk that way these days, and that there's very, very little left over of this concept. But it is a biblical one. And we stand on God's word, and I'm going to believe every word of it. And the concepts that the Lord brings forth about men and women and marriage and daughters, we need to get our understanding from Scripture, not from our culture. Giving a daughter to wife, this concept, it's literally almost completely lost today. I'm not even sure if modern weddings are even keeping the tradition of a father giving his daughter away. Some of you, and I don't even know. I mean, maybe some of the younger people here, if you've been to weddings, have you been to a wedding where the minister, whoever's performing the ceremony, says, you know, "Who gives this woman away?" Has anyone even seen that or heard that? And the father will say, "I do." Right? And because a father, traditionally, historically, will walk his daughter up the aisle to give her away at the wedding. This is the way, weddings have typically been done in our culture, in the United States, because it was followed after a pattern of what's right according to Scripture. Because it's a concept that's taught in Scripture. That the father is responsible for his daughter, and not only responsible, the father has the right to veto any vow that his daughter makes while his daughter is living at home under his roof. The Bible teaches that a man should leave father and mother to cleave unto his wife, that essentially the family is designed to have the children at home until you get married and leave. That's when you leave. It's not to go off and go to college and do other things. You stay in the home. You're part of the family. You help out the family. You help out mom and dad as you're getting older. And then when it's time for you to leave, when you find a spouse. And that's when you go. But the daughters are what, you know, the father is supposed to be looking out for and giving away to whom he deems to be essentially worthy of his daughter having, and somebody's looking out for his daughter. Exodus 22, we're going to see a little bit about this in the law. Look at verse number 16 in Exodus chapter 22. The Bible says, "And if a man entice a maid that is not betrothed," so she's not engaged, she's not married, right? She's just a single girl, and some man comes along, he entices her and lies with her, he shall surely endow her to be his wife. So he's saying, look, if a guy commits fornication with a girl, you know, neither of them are married, there's nothing like that, they just, you know, he just entices her, gets her to lay with him, then the Bible's saying, you know what, then he needs to marry her. Right then, you know, it's a sin, it's wicked, he shouldn't have done it, but now that he's done it, he's humbled her, they need to get married. And that's what's right to do, but there's a caveat to it. Look at verse 17. It says, "If her father utterly refused to give her unto him." So who has the right to say no to this? Dad does. You better believe it. According to God, according to God's law, the father has the right to say no. No, I'm not going to let you marry my daughter. And it says, he shall pay money according to the dowry of virgins. That the person that did that, that laid with her, if the father says no, then he still needs to give the dowry because he humbled his daughter. And he needs to receive, you know, he's basically, it's kind of like paying a fine. But in the Bible, when someone wanted to, you know, marry a woman, they would give a dowry unto the father of the girl, of you know, the daughter that wanted to get married. And, you know, you could go into all the different reasons why that might be. I think it shows someone who's going to be a provider and able to take care of the woman to say, hey, here's what I'm going to give you, you know, and just show you, like, I am a provider. I love her. I'm serious about this. I'm not just, you know, like when you go to make a big purchase, like a house, you put down earnest money, you don't get that back. Right? And that's showing, hey, I'm serious about this. I want to make this deal. I want to make this transaction. When a man brings a dowry for a woman, he's saying, I'm serious about this. I'm going to dedicate, you know, my life with her. This isn't just some flippant thing. This isn't just because I want to lay with her and then I'm just going to be done with her and then I'm just going to toss her aside. No, I'm treating this seriously. And because they didn't go the right way when they commit fornication, he still gets hit with that. Well, no, you still got to pay that dowry because, you know, you should have done this the right way to begin with, but now we're going to do this. But the point is that the father has that say-so. Turn, if you would, to Numbers chapter 30. We'll see this reinforced even further. Numbers chapter number 30. Numbers 30 establishes the authority of the father and the husband in the home. This is the way that God designed things. And you could call me, you know, a male chauvinist. You can call me whatever name you want to use. I don't care what I'm called because I'm just going to believe what God's word says and that this is fact and that this is truth. And that's how I'm going to live my life. And if it bothers you, then I don't care. But I'm going to teach this too. Because a lot of people don't know this. A lot of people have never even read Numbers. And I think everyone in this room probably has, but there's a lot of people who haven't read the book of Numbers because they think it's too boring. Right? Numbers. Oh, I don't know about Numbers. I'm just going to go and read Psalms or whatever, right? But there's a lot of good doctrine here. Numbers chapter 30, start reading verse number 1. The Bible says, and Moses spake unto the heads of the tribes concerning the children of Israel, saying, this is the thing which the Lord hath commanded. So verse number 1, this is what God said. Now just make this clear. This is what God commanded. Verse number 2, if a man vow a vow unto the Lord, or swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceedeth out of his mouth. Amen, amen. A man makes a vow, he needs to pay it. Very simple. Okay, verse number 3. If a woman also vow a vow unto the Lord and bind herself by a bond, being in her father's house in her youth, so now we're using a specific example, not just any woman, but a woman that's in her father's house and in her youth, right? She's not, you know, in her youth, you could, you know, it's not necessarily talking about a really little girl, but just in general, she's in her father's house, her dad's taking care of her, she's in her youth. It says in verse number 4, and her father hear her vow and her bond wherewith she hath bound her soul, and her father shall hold his peace at her. That means he doesn't say anything. He hears it, doesn't say anything. Then all her vows shall stand, and every bond wherewith she hath bound her soul shall stand. Amen. She makes a vow, dad hears it, doesn't say anything, then she's responsible for that vow that she made to the Lord. Verse number 5, but if her father disallow her in the day that he heareth, not any of her vows or her bonds wherewith she hath bound her soul shall stand, and the Lord shall forgive her because her father disallowed her. You say, but that's her personal relationship with God. What do you mean that her father can actually just step in and disallow her? Well, Welcome to the authority that God has given the father in the house over his daughter. And you know what? You keep reading this. It's not going to say over his son. It's over his daughter. Okay, I didn't write this book, but I read it and I study it. And this is what it says. Dad has the right to come in between a vow that a daughter wants to make to God and say, no, you're not going to make that vow. And God will hold her guiltless. It's not like she gets in trouble with God because now she can't keep her vow. Because God made the rules. He said, no, I gave him this power and this authority to be able to do this. You're forgiven. It's not on you because your dad didn't let you do it. This is also one of the reasons why I believe that a man gives away his daughter, because he's going to let her make a vow before God where she's going to promise to be with another man for the rest of her life. And, you know, I mean, when someone rebels and they leave home or whatever, you know, they're already rebelling. It's not, you know, that's not going to necessarily stand in that case. But when you've got the daughter at home, dad's at home, dad's raising her, dad's, you know, teaching her and whatever, he's going to give his daughter to someone that he seems to be fit. Now, it's not like he's picking and choosing who his daughter is going to marry. It doesn't say that dad is doing that or that dad should do that. But dad has the ultimate say-so to disallow her vows. So basically, the way that God, you know, has designed this, a girl should be able to choose who she wants to marry only in the Lord, according to Scripture, someone who's saved, someone who's, you know, and mom and dad should be doing a good job of teaching them who to look for, what traits to look for, who's going to be good for them. But at the end of the day, if dad thinks that my daughter's making a really, really big mistake here because this guy is just a big loser, and because dad knows men better than many women know men, especially when they're young, especially when they're kind of naive, especially when they think, oh, wow, you know, he's doing all this stuff for me, but God can see past that. God can see the games maybe he's trying to pull. God can see that this guy is a loser. This guy is not really a hard worker, and he's putting on a show, and he's giving her all this attention and flattering her to make her feel good just to get what he wants, but he's really just going to be a low-life piece of garbage and not do anything for her, not support her. Dad can say no. And that is an important role to take. Men, remember that with you, for your daughters, that, you know, you want your daughter to be happy for the rest of her life. They grow up depending on you because you're the man of the household. You're the one providing for the family. And biblically speaking, they ought to be cared for and provided for by another man when they leave your house, their husband. Their husband should be taking care of them. Their husband should be going to work and providing for them until the day that they die. The woman was not made to go out and just work for her own and support her own way and make her way through life. The woman has a different job to perform. And she's supposed to be taken care of by her father and then by her husband. And as dad, you need to make sure that your daughter is going to marry someone to the best of your ability, you know. Obviously, let her marry someone that she loves. Don't pick out, oh, you're going to marry this person. Let her find someone that she loves and wants to be married to, but just make sure that that guy is going to meet the standard. And this is what Caleb's doing. You're saying, because there was a, remember, Caleb chose, like, the hardest battle for him to fight and to win. So then he picks another hard place nearby, saying, okay, anyone that can defeat this place, you can have my daughter to wife. And he sets that bar high of someone who's willing to go out and fight the hard fight and win that battle in order to win over his daughter. He makes sure he's going to find her a strong, a capable husband for his daughter to marry. Now, he obviously loved his daughter because he gave her more than the blessing she even asked for. In Joshua 15, verse number 18, the Bible says, and it came to pass as she came unto him that she moved him to ask of her father a field, and she lighted off her ass, and Caleb said unto her, what wouldest thou? He's saying, what do you want? What would you like from me? Who answered, give me a blessing, for thou hast given me a south land. Give me also springs of water. So she's saying, hey, you gave me this great land. You know, thank you, Dad, for that. He says, but can I also have springs of water? And then it says, and he gave her the upper springs and the nether springs. So upper and lower. Nether just means lower. You see, they gave her two. Here you go. He loved his daughter, but he wanted her to be cared for. That's why he put that kind of standard on there. And, you know, that's what I'm going to be doing with my daughters. And, you know, if we keep on reading Numbers chapter 30, we're not going to do it tonight, because I was only focused more just on kind of the daughter aspect, the father-daughter, and what the father's authority is in the household. But you read it, it's the same thing with the wife. If a wife makes a vow to God and the husband hears it, he can say no. Yeah, remember that, ladies. Read the rest of this chapter when you get home tonight and tell me that's not so. You think you could just make whatever vow you want to God without your husband's approval? And if it's the case with your own vows with God, how much more does that carry forward into just general aspects of life? Now, just because God has given the husband that level of authority doesn't make the husband a tyrant. The husband can become a tyrant of his own and shouldn't, but that level of authority was granted by God, making the husband truly responsible for what goes on in the home. It's a big weight to have, men. Don't just give up your authority that God's given you, because he gave it to you for a reason. God's created men to lead and to lead in the home. And that's our job. And we whether you take it or not, it's still your responsibility, and God's going to hold you responsible for the way that your family is run and operated. And you need to take control of it. And especially in this wicked, backward, sinful society that we live in today, I mean, you'll get hated for saying the things that I say out loud because it's from this book. The world despises this type of teaching because it's completely contrary to what they teach and believe and what, you know. You may not all have the same experiences, but like myself and other people, other pastors I know especially, you know, when people are in trouble, they'll come and seek counsel. And usually, you know, oftentimes a pastor will hear a lot more things than other people might hear even in their lifetime, just because they're coming, being, you know, gone to as a source of help, right? Someone that needs help, they're having problems in their life. And I think that's part of the job, and it's, you know, it's the way it should be. But these days, there's so many problems in marriages. So many people are going through these hard times, and it just, every time I hear more and more and more and more and more, it's just like, it just becomes more and more obvious how far we've strayed as a culture and as a people, like, from the biblical model. And I'm not putting all the blame on one, you know, on the men or the women per se, because they're both really screwed up. But the role that's been skewed more than anything is the role of the woman, because there's been the masculizing of women in our culture to make women more like men, and to promote that the great value is being a man, not being a woman, which ultimately that's what feminism is. It's making a woman more like a man, which just degrades the value of women in the way that God made women. Don't be deceived by that by the world, by that wicked perversion of truth. If you're a woman, glory in the way that God made you and have respect unto his commandments, and you ought to be thankful and happy that you can actually focus on other things. You know, the man's job is really stressful if he's actually taking his job seriously. providing, working, training, leading, watching out for his children, you know, all this stuff. And I'm not saying a woman's job is not stressful, but it should be stressful in different ways. You don't have to worry about making all the decisions. Let your husband do that. Let him do that. It'll make your life happier. Let him take that job. Don't feel like you have to do it because that's the way that you were raised in this world, wickedly world, wisdom of the world. Let him do his job. And men, you know, take charge in your home. Take that role seriously. So those are the two main concepts that we see in Joshua chapter 15, that I saw in Joshua chapter 15 I wanted to teach on. Like I said, a lot of cities and towns and villages in Judah just getting this great amount of land. And that's kind of where we finish off the chapter. So be with us next week for chapter 16. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the timeless truths of the Bible. It's an old book, and the words are from everlasting and to everlasting, Lord, that they are timeless. There's no beginning and no end to the Word of God. And we thank you so much for providing the instruction for us to help us in this lifetime. And Lord, I just know personally speaking, the more I've been able to try to get right with you and our family has every single step of the way, the more close that we can make it to the way that your law state and the way that your word states, the happier we are. And I know so many other personal testimonies that are similar to your Lord. And if we could just recognize that and get over ourselves, get over our pride, get over the brainwashing, get over the perversion that the world teaches, and just accept and live the way that your word says, we truly will be full of joy. And we thank you so much for that guidance, Lord. Help us to have the faith. Help us to be encouraged and edified and to be around other like-minded believers to strengthen us, because the power and influence of this world can be strong at times. And when we're always around other people, either on the job or just out in the world, it can wear us down. And I pray that you would please help us to strengthen one another, and that we can just continue to do and live the way that you've told us to do. In Jesus' name.